Okay, as a summary to the financial appraisal techniques we've been looking at, we've got to remember that if an organisation has got spare money, it doesn't mean that they have to invest in projects. Yes, they could spend their spare cash on internal investments or projects, but as an alternative, they could go and buy external companies. So instead of develop a project themselves, they could find a little startup company that's developed this technology or developed a product. They could buy that company. If an organization has got cash, it doesn't mean they're going to invest it in your project ideas. They could use that money to reduce their overdrafts. I mean, companies have bank loans and overdrafts like normal people do. So if they've got extra cash, that doesn't mean they're going to invest it in a project. They could reduce the size of their bank loans. Companies that are listed on the stock market could actually decide that, yeah, they've got lots of spare cash, they've had a successful year, they're not going to invest it in projects, but they're going to return it to the investors as dividend payments. And by returning it to the investors as dividend payments, it maintains their share price, it makes them more unlikely to be purchased or to be bought by their competing companies. Now, there might be one or two students in the room that are sponsored by a company. So if a company's got spare cash, how could they use it? They could use it to sponsor some students. They could use it to invest in projects, but it's just one option. So if a company's got spare cash, they could use it to invest in projects, and they've got to decide which projects do we invest in and which projects don't we invest in. So our methods of payback, return on investment and net present value are methods to compare projects A and B to work out which is the best project for the company. Now, having said that companies run projects to make money, I'm now going to suggest that the best project for the company might not be the one that makes the most money. The projects are selected, yes, because of their financial returns, but we've also got to make sure we've got the resources available to do the project. It could be that we've got a certain type of resource that are quite idle. We haven't got enough work for them. They're working at under capacity. So we find a project that uses that resource. Alternatively, we could make those resources redundant, but then we're losing the capability for that type of work. We're selecting projects based on our cash flow forecasts. Can we afford to develop this new product over 2 or 3 years? Can we continue to invest money? Will we have money to invest in 2 years' time if we start now? We're choosing projects to develop our skills such that we can get better at what we do. Previous lectures, we've looked at portfolios of projects and suggested that companies need risky projects to stretch themselves, to develop themselves. And we could be choosing a project that stretches and develops the skills of our staffs to get into new markets. If we're working for a particular customer, we might choose to do a project as a loss leader. It doesn't make us money, but we're hoping that the company, the customer, will use us for other bigger projects that will make us money. Okay, in the introduction to this section, I said which project should we do, project A or project B? They have different investment rates, they have different terms, periods for the project. This is going to be a payback calculation, and we could put the cash flows into a spreadsheet to work out which month project A pays back and which month project B pays back. Project A pays back in 21 months, project B in 24 months. So the shorter payback project is project A. If I was to ask you which project you would do, you might say, well, project A. The real answer is we don't know. Do we have the resources to do project A? Do we have the skills to do project A? How risky are both projects? Do the senior managers support these projects? This lecture has been about looking at financial appraisal techniques, But having achieved an answer of a payback in 18 months or a return on investment of 10%, that is not the final decision about whether we do the project. We've got to consider the resources, the risks, the company's strategy. Another example, we looked at this and suggested, is it worth investing on this project? Cost of capital is 10%, 4-year project. This is a net present value calculation. And when we look at the value of £10,000 over the 4 years of this project, we can see it reduces £9,000, £8,000, £7,500, £6,800. And when we add those up, we get negative £300. So the net present value for this project is negative. It does not make us money. So I ask you, should we do the project? Usually most students say no, and I say, wrong answer. We don't know. Maybe this is a loss leader. Maybe this project is a loss leader and it enables us to bid for further work for this customer. Maybe this project keeps one of our resources busy. Look, it doesn't make us money, but it doesn't lose us much money either. Maybe this project enhances our skills. It enables us to get involved in a new technology that we have not been used to before. The project doesn't make us money, but it doesn't lose us money. So there are other reasons. Maybe the company's strategy says we will get involved in this project. Okay, so finally, our example looked at projects X, Y, and Z. And the company's in financial problems, so they're saying all projects must pay back within 12 months. So we're looking at the different investment values, the different development times, and we can do some simple calculations to work out that the benefits of Project X are £2,000 a month after month two. We're going to get £20,000 back in year one. It is going to pay back. And Project Y costs us £100,000. And after 6 months, we get £15,000 a month back. So in year one, we only get £90,000 back. We do not pay back on this project within 12 months. Project Z costs £100,000. We get £12,000 a month after the third month. So it gives us £108,000 in the first year. So it does pay back. So based on payback, we are going to do Project X. We are going to do Project Z. And we're going to reject the middle project, Project Y. And what a short-term decision that's been. Because if these projects last for 2 years, the figures are very different. Project X, which we are doing, remember, gives us another £12,000 of benefit in the second year. Project X, which we are doing, remember, gives us an extra £24,000 worth of benefit in the second year. Project Y, which we rejected, gives us £180,000 of benefit in the second year. Project Z gives us £144,000 worth of benefit. So actually the benefit from Project Y in year two exceeds the benefits from Project X and Project Z. So it can be a very short term view to use 12 months as a payback method. So all three methods, payback, return on investment, net present value, have been about the financial appraisal of a project. Usually the company that you work for will only use one of these methods. They'll tell you what it is and they'll tell you what the payback period should be or what the return on investment should be, what the required net present value is. They're used to compare projects with each other to select the projects that are best, and best might not mean most profitable. However, all the methods look at future returns, and we can't be sure of the future. We can't predict the future. I've been suggesting that you're going to get £60,000 back in year five. That is not going to be accurate. Things are going to change. Now, an equation that you will need is to understand that your profit are going to be the sales minus your costs. Well, how good are these predictions? Can you really estimate your sales to within 10% accuracy or 20% accuracy? What if your costs increase? What if your costs increase due to exchange rate changes, oil price changes? If you're making anything out of plastic, it's based on the price of oil. If you're selling your products in the American market, it depends on the value of the dollar. So how sensitive are you to these changes? We can't predict the future, but we do need to understand how sensitive we are to the changes. So we may draw some sort of graph or some sort of figure that says as we invest in the project, our cash flow goes down. We calculate our profit and our payback period. And then we can do some what-if calculations. What if our sales are 10% lower than forecast? What if the dollar-pound exchange rate changes to $1.50 to the pound? What does that do to our profit? What does that do to our return on investment? So when you present the results to senior management, you can't just say the return on investment is 12%. You need to say, based on these figures, the return on investment is 12%. And even if the dollar exchange rate falls to 1.5, the return on investment will still exceed 10%. So we need to understand this sensitivity. You'll find that sometimes the project is very sensitive to certain things. Some of the work I did with Nokia was relevant to getting a new phone to the market at the critical point of the year. The critical point of the year for the mobile phone market still tends to be just before Christmas. Nokia, I'm talking 5 to 8 years ago now, Nokia were clearly saying, if we are late to market, we make no profit. They worked out that they could double their development costs. As long as they weren't late to market, they could double their development costs and still make a profit out of a particular project. Being late to market is just not allowed. So the financial appraisal. It's done early on in the project at a very high level. Should we investigate this project in more detail? And if the senior management say yes, then we need to do a more detailed financial analysis to allow those senior managers to say, yes, this project is for us, it's worth our investment. Or no, there is a better project, we're going to spend our money on something else. Remember that projects will not be accepted purely on the amount of money. Have we got the resources? How risky is the project? Does this project help us develop our skills? Are we going to do this as a loss leader for the customer? So financial appraisal has been about deciding which project to do and understanding that the company has bigger financial concerns staying in business, maintaining their cash flow, rather than going bankrupt halfway through the development of a new project. So post-lecture work, go and have a look at the financial analysis or cost-benefit analysis of any project management book that's available in the library. See which methods they suggest and the drawbacks and advantages. We'll be doing this in the seminar as an exercise for you to decide whether you're going to invest in a project.